Hello, and welcome to the first in the series of videos aimed at developing retro games in vanilla JavaScript, using the canvas element. My name is Anthony, and please join me in my corner of the web, where I like to build stuff within the browser using the latest technologies. So, confession time. I'm a gamer, and I have been for quite a while now. I know, a shock to everyone, right? Well, like many gamers, it's always been my dream to develop games. Making something that tells a story and creates an interactive world whose own set of unique characters with the aim to entertain people and possibly inspire them is quite a tempting proposition. I'm sure the majority of developers, young and old, have gotten into producing code just because of their past experience with gaming. If you have seen any of my past videos or projects, you'll know that I genuinely enjoy making retro-styled games. And just like any other skill, such as writing and painting for example, one of the many ways you can improve and learn is to copy from the people who came before you. And with this in mind, I think trying to replicate some of our favourite games from the past is always a great starting point for any wannabe game developer. And funnily enough, that is exactly what we'll be attempting to do in this video series. I'll be delving into an old classic, seeing how it ticks, and looking to see if we can rebuild a section of it for research purposes. I'm sure you've already seen the title card, and yes, in this instance, we'll be attempting to build a Street Fighter 2 clone, or at least a couple of the selectable characters and their corresponding stage backgrounds. We may even throw in the title and the character select screens, just for good measure. In this specific video, however, we'll first look at some of the tooling you can use to get the project up and running. In future videos, I'll continue to show you how to use these tools to produce the game for the browser. Ultimately, we'll look to build this together and hopefully demonstrate what is possible using the latest web technologies. I honestly don't expect this video to be everyone's bag, but I thought it would be best to use this as a starting point and possibly remove any initial questions people may have. If all of that sounds like something that may interest you, why not click the like button on this video and subscribe if you wish to follow the series. Remember to click the bell icon to be notified when a new video comes out. All in all, I hope you have fun, and if nothing more, we should at least learn something new along the way. So to kick us off, let's jump straight into some of the tools and packages which I personally use for web development. Obviously, I'll prefix this to say these are just my personal preference and what I currently use at the time of writing. So yeah, these may change in the future. However, I'll also try to offer some alternatives which some of you may otherwise prefer. If you feel I've missed anything though, which to be fair, I probably have, why not drop a message in the comment section and share the tools and preferences which you prefer. I think this is a pretty obvious one to be fair, as every developer needs an editor to write their code. Preferences do tend to come and go, but in recent years the majority of the front-end developer space has come to settle on VS Code. And I'll be honest, I'm no different. Not to be mistaken for its big brother, Visual Studio though, which is mainly used by more general developers for full stack projects. You could use it for front-end development, but to be fair, it is considered overkill. VS Code, however, is its smaller cousin and is an extremely productive lightweight development text editor. It's available for all major platforms and it itself is actually written in front-end technologies, which is why you may have seen it running in the browser these days, through such websites as GitHub or even Code Sandbox. For me though, I've come to like it because of its vast amount of extensions that really do extend its functionality beyond anything I could have imagined. This allows you to mold it to your own personal development tastes. That said, if you're not a fan of Microsoft or for some reason VS Code, you have a vast amount of alternatives to choose from these days. I'll list some here that I've used in the past. First up is Atom, which is probably VS Code's main competitor at the moment, and is developed and maintained by GitHub, which funnily enough is now owned by Microsoft. From what I remember, I actually enjoyed my experience with Atom when it first came out, but ultimately I went back to VS Code. Honestly, I'm not entirely sure why either, as there was nothing particularly wrong with it, but then maybe I didn't see anything to persuade me to jump ship either. But yeah, I'd highly recommend giving it a try at least, as it is free to use. Next up, there's WebStorm, which is another solid editor by JetBrains. However, as it's a paid product, this generally means it's used by enterprises rather than your general hobbyist. So unless you have bought into their ecosystem, it's hard to recommend this one today. That said, I know they currently have another IDE in the works called Fleet, which I haven't used yet, but possibly something to keep an eye on. Then there's Sublime Text. Even though it's just a text editor, it's a solid one. It's well loved and many still swear by it. However, it can be seen as old hat these days, especially in the front-end space. Even though there is a free version, if I remember correctly, there was a constant nagging message for you to upgrade to the paid version. Just something to be aware of. And lastly, I suppose I should mention that you can use a bare minimum notepad tool, such as Notepad++. This is probably aimed more towards the old school developers out there who prefer a stripped down experience sans all bells and whistles. Honestly though, there's nothing wrong with these type of editors, as again, they are generally all round good performers. Notepad++, however, is Windows only, but I'm sure there are many similar Notepad-esque editors available for other platforms, if that's your thing. As we'll be dealing with files other than those of the code variety, let's examine what other tools you'll also need to have in your artillery, starting with graphics. I'll be honest, I have and use a lot of different graphics tools, each having its own particular type of job. If you don't draw graphics yourself, these may not be overly important to you, but you'll still need to have at least one of these to edit your graphics files, primarily for creating your sprite sheets, but we're getting ahead of ourselves. So obviously the first one on the list is Adobe Photoshop, which we all know has some of the best image editing capabilities available today, and is usually the first stop for most people. It can still be used for pixel art too, but it does take some time to set up the tooling to allow this. For me personally, I wouldn't say it's the most efficient way of doing it, but if you're familiar with the product suite, then you might feel right at home here. That is, if you can swallow the monthly fee. There's also GIMP, which has become one of the most popular paint and art tools, mostly for its name unfortunately, but there is a good reason. Commonly compared to Photoshop, it mostly has all the same features, but with the advantage of being free. Although it might be difficult for first-time users, as its UI does take a little more time getting used to, it's generally seen as a great all-rounder, even if it does lean more towards image editing. In the same vein, we have Krita, which again comes equipped with mostly the same drawing features. It should be noted this isn't really aimed at pixel art, but it does do a great job as an image editor, while having some unique drawing creative tools. Again, it's another free art tool, so there's no real reason not to at least give it a try. Now let's move on to a couple of the more dedicated pixel art editors. If you personally draw sprites or look to animate them, you probably already have at least one of these installed on your machine. So I personally use GraphicsGale, and I have done for as long as I can remember. It's looking a little dated now, and unfortunately has not been updated for quite a number of years. But that said, it's free, and yes, it has all the tools you'd want to use to push your pixels and animate them. It is Windows only, so here are a number of alternatives, which I'm sure most of you have already heard about. Like GraphicsGale, A-Sprite comes with some of the best pixel art tool essentials with a retro-style interface. It includes onion skinning, shading and blending modes, and even gives you the ability to create sprite sheets and tile-based editing. For me, I'm not overly a fan of the interface, but there's no doubting the power this pixel editor can do, so it does come highly recommended. Another well-loved pixel drawing tool is ProMotion NG. Again, it comes with an array of tools and features to aid you in creating graphics and animations for your pixel-based games. It's been around for a number of years now, and has grown with the industry. Honestly, it's another great tool to have, but the UI does take a little getting used to. Many professional game studios like Ubisoft, Gameloft and Halfbrick use ProMotion NG for their games, so you know it must have something going for it. Even though it's primarily a Windows-based tool, both a free and a paid version are available for all platforms. A special shout out to Squoosh, which is a free online tool for converting graphics to and from different formats. I tend to use WebP over PNG these days as it creates such smaller files and is supported by all major browsers. And as we all know, smaller files are better for load times, which is great for people who have slower internet. So this tool is generally useful for me in the final stages, as it allows me to get the most out of my graphics files. And lastly, in the graphics department, I'll cheat somewhat and mention Tilehead here. Even though we won't be using it in this project, it's highly recommended if you're building scrolling maps, such games as platformers or scrolling beat-em-ups. It would have been rude not to include it in this list as it's so useful. Maybe one to walk through another day though. As for sound, I'll be honest, this is probably the area I'm least experienced in. So obviously, I won't spend too much time on this one. When it comes to doing anything audio file related, I personally use Audacity. It's another awesome and free sound editing tool. I mainly use it to edit and trim music tracks and sound effects for my games. You can then export the results out to web-friendly sound files such as OGG or MP3. The only snag I found is that the UI is seriously overdue a massive overhaul. If you can get over that, it is a very impressive addition to your toolset. The only alternative that springs to my mind at the moment to Audacity is Adobe's Audition, which unfortunately, like most of the other Creative Cloud suite apps, comes under one of the massive monthly fees. Just like Photoshop though, and the other numerous apps Adobe offers, you can't go wrong with this application, as it is generally seen as the best in the class. I'd actually be interested for any further recommendations you have here, as there must be other great audio editing tools out there that I've missed. So the last thing I'd like to touch on is the resources we'll be using in the game. And unfortunately, one of the things I should mention is a little thing called copyright. As I don't legally own any of the assets for the game we're developing in the series, I won't be able to offer them out as they are still under copyright to their legal owners. But as we're simply doing this as part of a learning exercise, we should be fine, in quotes, under the Fair Use Act. So whereas the code we produce will be our own, the assets will not. And if nothing else, you can substitute the assets with your own, as the methods and code we produce here should be enough to provide you with some good understanding of what goes into creating your own fighting game. With regards to the resources we'll be using for this tutorial series, I'll be referencing a number of resource sites online. These sites host a selection of ripped assets by fans from various games and media for reference purposes. I'll list them here for transparency, but let's be clear, I don't endorse or sponsor anything they provide, but I'm greatly appreciative as it definitely makes my life easier going into this. For sprites, the best site I've found is Sprite as Resource, as it has a wide range of graphics from various systems. As far as I'm aware, the site is driven by fan submissions, where they can upload sprite sheets, static backgrounds, and various other graphics from their favourite games. For ourselves though, the site hosts sprite sheets for both Ryu and Ken and their respective stage backgrounds. Another good reference that is aptly named is Video Game Music, which is hosted by Kinsider. Just like the previous site, this houses various soundtracks, music, and sound files for a large number of games. I'll be using the Street Fighter 2 soundtrack, which has a number of samples of the background music and sounds. We'll use this primarily for authenticity purposes. There are also a number of other sites out on the web that go into great detail with regards to the technical side of Street Fighter 2, such as the Cutty Ream Floor. I won't be listing others here just yet though, as we'll be referencing a number of them as we continue through the video series. These will go into the details of the sprite sheets, hitboxes, moves, frame timings, etc., which will all be beneficial for replicating the feel of the original game. And there we have it. You now know the tools I use, and are hopefully on the same page as me to start developing games for the web. I obviously didn't mention that you'll also need a web browser, but for clarity, I personally test the games in both Chrome and Firefox. The code we produce should be fine in any modern browser, however, but I'll detail any oddities that crop up that may affect certain ones. In the next video, we'll jump straight in, create our starter project, and take a look at the canvas element. We'll examine how you can set it up and look to start drawing shapes and images to it. We may even configure the main animation loop and examine what frames are and how that affects what we draw to the screen, so please stay tuned for that. And to finish then, as a small teaser for those who have stayed until the end, I've included a video of the latest build of my Street Fighter code to demonstrate what we're looking to build in the coming videos. The biggest difference you'll notice since the last preview is that we now have a title screen. This is hopefully authentic to the original as it pans up the building and then into the actual title screen itself. Hopefully so far this looks familiar to anyone who's played the original arcade game. We now also have the character select screen. Even though you can select any of the 8 characters here, the game will only recognise Ken or Ryu at the moment. As you can see, I picked Zangief, but as we get into the game, you'll see that I'm still Ryu, even though it does say Zangief at the top of the screen. This is forced within the code, however, and is mainly due to the fact that I don't have any other characters set up or configured in the battle stage. Jumping back to the player select screen using the second player star button, you'll notice their cursor also appears on screen. Although again, no matter which character you choose, it will still randomly default to either Ryu or Ken. I've also added the signposts as background objects, to test if they would scroll properly with the stage background. And finally, we are able to pit two characters together here, where Ken is fighting himself in this battle. And as we come to an end in this video, I'd like to thank everyone who has made it this far. I hope to see you in the next one, which should hopefully be sometime next month. Speak soon, and out.